So, hello everyone, I'm Ezgi from Humanitarian OpenStreetMap Team Turkey. Our project is quite new, it has a 1 year passed. Normally today my friend will be presenting. She is the outreach of our project that I'm gonna mention you about right now with more field stories, but she couldn't make it due to visa issues. So yeah, we are Humanitarian OpenStreetMap Team Turkey. We are also registered as a Turkish association, which is called Çizenler. Before talking about the organization, I want to mention what is the situation in Turkey and why we started this project, which is called Crowdsourcing Non-Camp Refugee Data Project. This is a general setting of Turkey. As you all know about the Syrian crisis, Turkey's borders with Syria, and right now Turkey is hosting 3.7 million Syrian refugees in Turkey, and this influx began in the recent years. Now the number is huge and government is having difficulties in providing services for all the refugees who need access to basic services, basically. These are some facts and numbers. And in fact, Humanitarian OpenStreetMap team is conducting this crowdsourcing non-camp refugee data project also in Uganda. The context is quite similar, but the country's situation is totally different. But the context is similar because Uganda is hosting a lot of refugees and they need access to services provided. So that's why we started this project, to help refugees access to services, mostly through OpenStreetMap. And our project is called Building Istanbul's Needs and Assistance, BINA. So our objectives were first of all, like some OSM knowledge sharing, base map improvement, and mapping disadvantaged communities, services. This is very important because, in fact, Istanbul is a huge city which has 20 million population. And also considering all these number of refugees, the information is changing rapidly. There are so many NGOs and INGOs opening and closing, changing services all the time. And there is a mess right now going on, and everyone is aware of that. And information dissemination is a big issue in Istanbul. There are some services provided, but it is so crowded. Some people have no idea about it. When they know about it, that service is already closed, and locations are changing. As you might know, it is very, very hard to conduct a project like that. But also, there is another issue about OSM. OSM is not that commonly known in Turkey. OSM data is extremely poor in Turkey. Government has really developed maps which are quite accurate, prepared by QGIS or ArcGIS, and that's why they are also reluctant to help development of OSM, especially in means of refugee response. This was our biggest challenge, then that's why we decided to make this project, to improve this OSM knowledge, first of all. And then we support partners to conduct mapping and develop a service delivery database and develop proof of concept migrant guide to the region, which is called, which all the registration and the ID card, all these important services are provided. So that's why we started with mapathons, in fact. Like, this is our first activity as Hot Turkey in Istanbul, because mapathons are really important for people to get to know us more than the organization, but there is something called OSM, how can it be used? And mapathons in our project played a very, very important role, more than everything. And we did it with Doctors Without Borders, MSF. They were always helping us reach out to more and more people, because they had a huge number of volunteers already. And it became super useful for us, because many people working in big other big organizations, even they weren't aware of there is something called OpenStreetMap and we can use it this way. And also, apart from mapathons, we also provide trainings to refugees themselves for them to map the services that they are using. This was the base of our project. And here you can see some photos from one of our trainings. We reach out to community centers, and we had an outreach team which was very, very vital for our project, because we want the refugees know the services they are using more than us. Like, we didn't want to do it for them, or we don't want anybody else to do it, but also this way they can feel the sense of belonging, they are doing something. So we provided these multilingual maps, both in Turkish and Arabic, and we encouraged the many people from community centers to map their own environment. And this is one of the maps they developed with the help of us. As I said, our main aim is to encourage people to do it more than we doing it. And also we established the first youth mappers chapter in Istanbul Technical University. This is the first time in Turkey for a university, because university students were very important for us too in our project. We had a, this was the pilot project for HOT, and that's why we had a very, we were short of staff basically. That's why we needed support from universities and community centers and other NGOs. This played a vital role because university students did internship with us and they helped to improve the data of Istanbul, which was really poor. I'm gonna show you some before and after pictures so you will understand that it really wasn't that developed. So here you see a map of Istanbul. In fact, this is just roughly showing the percentage of the refugees. This is how we started our project, where we started. And the percentage was more important for us to see where the refugees are mostly based, and also it means there will be services needed and provided. These areas, you can see Zeytinburnu, Fatih and Sultanbeyli. We just finished these three areas with digitizing and also field mapping and validating. And it took us almost 8 months to complete it, because we collected, first we needed to digitize the buildings, roads, names, and it is super dense. Even Fatih, is, you see, maybe you know, that is the place where all the historical parts and all important tourist attractions are existing as well. Even in Fatih, there are 1 million people living in the city, which can be normally a city, you know, and this is only one district. That's why we, our job was really, really hard to develop this OSM data. Now I want to mention some challenges at the same time. You can see how dense Istanbul is in those regions especially, and when there are some also illegal refugee settlements, it can be very, very tough to identify buildings via digitizing, like doing remote mapping basically. So this is Fatih before we started our project. This was looking like that, and right now you can see it is totally detailed, and we collected more than 10,000 services points in both Arabic and Turkish language. Here you can also see from a more detailed picture, like before and after in the districts that we worked. But yes, this was also challenging, like as an idea. I would like to mention this because many humanitarian organizations are sometimes doing this. Something seems really nice as an idea. For example, like, yeah, refugees mapping the services provided for them and the services they are using, but also training them to conduct field mapping where there is no OSM data existing. We had so many problems in validation. It took us also ages to validate those points because there were a lot of mistakes, of course, made, and this was also an issue for us because we work with volunteers after giving trainings, and that's why we thought, okay, then we need more support from NGOs, because government wasn't being that collaborative. In, as I told you, they don't really trust OSM. First of all, there needs to be an awareness growing, and then we can offer them, yeah, we need to do a project together to provide services. So yeah, validation was an issue. It's not that visible in here, but so many spelling mistakes, especially in Turkish language. In fact, language and some areas, some points were taken twice, things like that. So that's why we wanted to try a different method at the when our project is processing. Right now, we are also giving trainings to NGO workers. This became also vital for us because NGO workers are also having difficulties in information sharing, like no one is aware what others are doing, even they are big NGOs. Also about the government services, addresses change and the situation context changes rapidly. So we provide training to NGO workers to say, okay, there is something like that, you can use it. You can use some platforms to show the services that you are using. You can just share it with your beneficiaries. And also, you can share it between other NGOs and other service providers. For this, in fact, we use UMAP. Maybe some of you recognize this platform. UMAP is very easy to use, and when you are training people for the first time for OSM, who are normally outreach people or social workers, who are normally working in the field, but they have no idea about technicals. We can't expect them to really, we can't expect them to use QGIS or other mapping platforms very easily. So this was quite easy for them to learn and use. That's why we encourage them to map the services they are using and their beneficiaries are using. And if they want, they can share. This is the good side of UMAP, because some information is, you know, when it comes to refugee response, some information is really private and you wouldn't like to share it. So this platform has been really useful. This was like the biggest lesson learned for us. And this way, right now, everyone is sharing information easily. Like right now, we are doing NGO coordination meetings and everyone is happy about it. Now, at least there is an awareness growing. And also these NGOs, this is also an example. This is in fact a brochure. Like there are sometimes today community service, community centers, there are people coming to ask questions, where can I get there, the services change. And this is about the address change. And in fact, it is the migration center. They keep changing addresses all the time, and some people are having difficulties in accessing that information. So they prepare a brochure, we help them. And they just spread it to people, also to the beneficiaries that which have access to internet, which there are many, in fact. In Istanbul, the context is different. And most of them have smartphones, in fact, and most of them are using internet. That's why they can also follow these UMAP platforms, or they can keep using OSM to navigate themselves. So this is the end of my presentation. I would like to answer the questions about doing a refugee project, if you have any. Because in fact, there is a lot to tell. Like, we face so many problems. We lived and learned, basically. And it would be nice to share information. Thank you.
Any question?
So I came in a bit late, but it is actually, you had the refugees do some of the mapping also, or is...
Yes.
Yeah, so, or only the refugees, or is a combination of HOT members or community members from Istanbul?
No, like the project's aim was, in fact, like crowdsourcing non-camp refugee data for services provided for refugees. For that part, services provided for refugees, we wanted them to map the services that they are using. But before there is the digitization, we needed to develop OSM data in Istanbul, which was really poor, as you could see in the slides. Yeah. So for that, we worked with NGO workers and mainly university students, and also we did it ourselves. But when it comes to the services provided for them, we encourage them to do it.
Yeah, so once the basic infrastructure buildings, roads were in there, then they mapped points of interest that were for refugees. That's the kind of situation?
Yes, sort okay. of, yes. Yeah. We can say it that way.
Thank you. Hello.
Hello.
I also arrived after 5 minutes, so I missed the beginning. I'd be quite interested in the politics of it. We know that the Turkish government is a little bit, I say this, restrictive in terms of social media content, mm-hmm. with Twitter, with other networks. What is their position towards OSM and towards what you do? There is a migration mm-hmm. crisis in Turkey, maybe you said it, so you have 3 million refugees from Syria in the Middle East. So are they, do they perceive you as a help in their attempt to manage the flow of refugees, or is your work perceived as something a bit on the margins? Thank you.
I thank you. That's a very good question, in fact. Yeah, we are talking about a country, Wikipedia is still blocked. And that's why the open data is not the most favorite thing for the government right now, unfortunately. And they are aware that, of course, they need some help in response to refugees. In fact, government is doing a lot still, like, I should be fair in that, like, in fact, refugees, if they are registered, some of them don't get registered on purpose because they want to leave the country for other, to end up in other countries, but registered refugees have access to healthcare. Yeah, there might be some problems, but at least basic healthcare, they can always get the basic healthcare in public hospitals, just like Turkish citizens, let's say. And education, they have access to education, but still there are some problems. For example, yeah, they can go to school, but some kids just come here and they can't speak Turkish, they need to adapt the school, and of course there is some hostility towards them. So they always look for ways to provide their own services. You know, there are Syrian schools or some, I shouldn't say, unofficial Syrian schools as well, or unofficial clinics, things like that. And it's happening, and government is aware of that, but they are being they are definitely not being supportive to many NGOs because, as I said, they are providing some services and they want to control it themselves. Like, they want it to be under control. So OSM is not that okay for us. Like, we, in fact, initially we wanted to cooperate with the municipalities for the project more than NGO workers because they could help us a lot. They could have, like, because our field teams also faced problems like, there are a group of refugees and the locals are annoyed by them. What are you doing with your phones? And they are doing field mapping, in fact. And we received so many phone calls because of that. They were under, and they were threatened by the locals sometimes, like, we are going to call the police. What are you doing? And they try to explain, we are not doing something illegal. You know, there is this understanding, and that's why municipalities' help could be great. But we talked to many municipalities, like many municipalities in Istanbul, but they are just saying, no, we don't understand why refugees are mapping Istanbul. Like, they don't really understand the issue of that. And they are annoyed by the fact that someone is doing mapping, which they can't really control. So it is a big issue, in fact. But they were never really blocking our work. But they just said, no, if you want to do it, do it. It seems nice, okay, but there is no help from us, basically. That's why we just turned our faces to NGOs more than government. Yeah, could be like, but we are partners with UNHCR. In fact, I want to mention that too. For example, in this project, that's why I said there are so many things to mention. Like, and in this project, we needed to find the gaps that government is not doing to be able to be recognized, because there are so many NGOs in Istanbul right now, and there is a mess, really, like, you can't follow the information. And we were talking to UNHCR because they are doing a services mapping for refugees, but none of the refugees are using it because the real things that they are using, like unofficial schools or unofficial clinics, but they are gonna keep using that. So this is an issue, and UNHCR was also saying that, look, your advantage in here, you should always focus on that. We can't show everything. We are aware that there are some things missing in our services mapping, and we get a lot of complaints about it, but you can just map the real services which are used, which are going to be used, which was our advantage, and we always mentioned that when we are talking to NGOs or universities, let's say.
Other questions? Okay, so now there is lunch. We are back here at 2 o'clock. Thank you.
Thank you.